In a world where it seems like everything is fighting for your attention, in the first 10 to 15 seconds of a song are where it's absolutely crucial. In this clip, Daniel explains his process to mixing the intro of Bend by Volumes in order to grab the listener's attention and set the tone for the rest of the song. Check it out and enjoy.
So let's get this first little section, intro. And you know, I'm going to start marking these because I didn't do that before. Okay. We want this to feel really big when it pops in. Let's see how the transition is. It's almost feeling like it's a little bigger than the next part to me. So just right off the bat, before I do anything else, I'm going to ride output gain on my mix bus compressor, -1 dB for the intro. Obviously, the reason I'm not riding the volume on my master bus or anything else is because I want my ozone to be always clipping right at the top, -0.3 true peak. I don't want, if I'm automating, I'm on my master up or down, it's not going to do that. So I just want to feed into my limiter differently. All right, so we got to make this section sound like a little smaller. Okay, first we have this guitar guy. I'm gonna just thin him out a little bit. And I've got the RC20 on there, which is always fun. I have it in mono right now, but I can actually go in stereo for a little weirdness. Which I kind of like because it's like setting you up for there to be something wide coming in. So why don't we just leave that there? I'm not going to fuss too much over that. I've got my filter too. I think the filter's a little steep too. I'm going to start it lower. Higher. So let's look at these drums, the production drums. It's a little weird, small sounding, this little snare guy. I'm gonna juice him up a tiny bit really quick. I'm gonna do the micro warmer. And we can hear the difference. I'll just like solo these two. Okay, so it sounds cool, but there's this little like clip thing at the top, like a transient. I want to shave that off. Okay, so that did that. And it's like two snare samples, so that second one has more of like a low mid resonance. I'm going to take care of that. But I'm actually only going to do it for when that appears. Shave off some highs. Sounds a bit cooler now. And then we have these like kind of stompy kicks. And I want to control those a little bit. Actually, I'm going to use the API. Everyone's favorite awesome compressor. I'm gonna turn it up super loud so I can hear where I get the best attack. Find the best settings. I'm looking for that more of a click. Cool, let's try that. Yep. Cool. I'm feeling like this guitar lead here has more mid-range than the rest of the song. All these things have to live in the world of the song, right? So if something has a bunch of mid-range, the rest of the song doesn't really yet. There's no vocals in it, so I'm gonna dip some out. Maybe up here. And I'm gonna lower this whole guy. Let's hear how that sounds going in. Not bad. The sweep up needs to be juiced, I think. Probably the whole track, because I'm assuming the rest are going to be like that too. All right, so now the way that I mix once I get into automation mode is I'm going to be just looping the section to get the most out of it. Right now, I want to get the most out of those snare hits, and I want to get the most out of this section feeling really powerful. So what I'm probably going to do is I'm going to go over to my snare room track, and I'm going to trim automation that up for this first section. Poking out a little much. Maybe it's just going to be for those first two snare hits. Perfect. Last thing I'm hearing is I think I might have gone a little overboard with the EQ on this. It's a little bit stringy. Perfect. My snare might be a little loud in general, I'm noticing too. All right, so now we're hitting a down section. So let's see what we got. All production drums. See those drums in the intro, I wanted them to be more small so the next part can feel bigger, but here they're kind of taking over for the drum set. So we got to make sure that these are knocking properly. This kick has something I don't love in it, which is some of that high end. I don't think it needs it. And there's a little boxiness in it too. And I'm going to do something to this whole production drum bus, which because they're like fake drums, we can sort of heighten the senses when we're listening to those a little bit. And I'm going to throw up this imager just so we can kind of have them widened out. Loop right. Now we have to start looking at the synths more because they're kind of leading this section. It's the synths and that one guitar lead, which I'm happy with where that guitar lead is. But this one comes in here. I think we can do a little work on that. Creating some space. We can turn that down. Let's hear how that sounds when it enters. Nice. Lastly, I'm gonna send my kicks, my production kicks, to my kick sidechain bus, which should be on my production bus. Let's see. Yeah. We might have to add another one to the sub bass, but let's see how that feels. Because I still want this production kick to also have that same impact where it's kind of dipping everything out when it hits. Not that much, but that's an extreme example, right? So remember we were favoring the sub in the kick over the low mid. So I'm going to kind of do the same situation here between this programmed kick and the sub bass. Oh, another thing. If you listen to this bass, and if just looking at it, it's kind of moving in volume. And I don't really want that. I only want it to move when the sidechain is opening it. What I'm going to do is I'm going to hit the MV2 on there. It's helping a little. And I'm going to hit another just normal compressor. This has a look ahead. I might turn that on. I don't think I'm going to. See, so now that's more locked in. It's not moving all over the place. So we have that really solid low end there. And then I'm going to take out some of the sub in that because we have that in our electronic kick drum.